It lies below the south tip of the Wolds in Lincolnshire, and it was called East Kirkby, after the village less than half a mile away. If you were to ask old bomber men what was the focal point on their airfields, you might get a lot of different answers. The flight office, the briefing room, the mess. I know one or two fellows who tell you the WAF quarters. But for me, and most of us, I think, it would be the flight control building, the watchtower, the nearest building to the aircraft and the runways. That balcony up there, that's where the top brass used to gather at takeoff time. Sometimes their sight of the aircrew in their cabins and their turrets as the bombers taxied by would be the last that would be seen of them in this world. The watchtower was the airfield's heart. It was where the people worked who talked to you when you were taking off and landing, who gave you the green light for go and red for don't, who tried to stop you bumping into other aircraft in the circuit, and who sent the fire truck and the ambulance if you made a mess of things. Every watchtower had its RT call sign. At East Kirkby, it was Silk Sheen. It's quite common on old airfields, when all the other buildings have long gone, for the watchtower to remain, but only as a shell, derelict and hollow. This has been rather specially looked after by a local farmer called Fred Panton.
I was brought up round here during the war, and I remember this airfield as if it was yesterday, and I had an older brother, and he was killed on Hops, like so many more was. And it's always been in my memory of those days, and this airfield, part of it came up for sale, and I was very interested in the watchtower, and I thought, me and my brother thought it was a would be a good idea if we put it back to its original form in the memory of those lads that gave their lives in that period. And that's what we're trying to achieve.
The trouble with most airfields was that they were miles away from anywhere. Not so at East Kirkby. 5 minutes' walk from the guardroom brought you to the village cross. In the first part of the war, this was what they called a K-site, a decoy airfield with a dummy flare path and bombs made of plywood and canvas, to divert the Luftwaffe's attention from all the proper bomber bases in this part of Lincolnshire. The farming folk around here accepted that, just as they'd accepted the assaults of man and nature down the centuries. And then, in 1943, when the real airfield was built, and the Lancasters arrived with their air crews and mechanics and cooks and clerks and armourers, the people here accepted that too. And in their quiet way, took the squadrons to their hearts. There was social contact too, centered, as so often, on the pub. The Red Lion was the squadron's local. On stand-down nights and scrubs, it would be full of air and ground crew, so full that if you wanted to fall down, you couldn't. Of course, on ops nights, it would be the way it is now. But on the full nights, If you had a glass to drink your Bateman's bitter from, then you'd better hold on to it all evening or make do with a jam jar. And they had a little ritual. Whenever one of the air crews finished their 30th operation, the last one of their tour, they would carve their names on here. Most of them have faded with the years, and there weren't all that many of them anyway. Sid Smith, he's one that made sure of being remembered. He was a flight engineer. Flight engineers were a new breed then in aircrew. They took the place of second pilots in the heavy bombers and acted as a sort of pilot's mate, watching temperatures and pressures, managing the fuel supply, and being Mr. Fix-It wherever they were needed. A lot of pilots taught their engineers to fly the aeroplane, well enough to keep it in the air while the skipper paid a visit to the Elson toilet, or just in case he happened to get hit. Teamwork was important. That was why crews tried to stick together through those 30 flights. Only a minority of crews, maybe one in five, survived to fly that 30th operation. Usually you'd get a comparatively easy one for that. Some target where there wasn't too much shot and shell. And we'd been counting on that. When we heard it was Berlin, I was slightly horrified. I'd been there 8 times before and knew what it was like. I marched into the flight commander's office and asked him if he was trying to kill me and my crew. I said, if we get the chop on this one, I'll come back and haunt you. And you'll never get a good night's rest again. And he just grinned and said, have a good trip and see you at breakfast. So we got briefed and kitted up. Just as we were climbing on board, the word came through from the watchtower that takeoff was postponed 4 hours. And my navigator, Jim Cassidy, he suggested the station cinema, and the crew truck brought us down here. The film was Casablanca, Bogart, Ingrid Bergman. Every now and then, someone way out on the airfield ran an engine up, and my heart missed a beat. And in the film, Sam, the little pianist, played As Time Goes By. We thought that was quite appropriate. That magic number 30, you'd come to know your airfield pretty well. Well enough to know it in the dark from all the others around here. And so you should, because it was a real disgrace to land at someone else's base, unless you really had to. You got to know the patterns that the railways and rivers made, the crossroads and canals. You knew where the church towers were and the windmills. They had sails in those days. All the landmarks were important, and not just for navigation. Some of them had other uses too. The aircrew used this windmill as a weather vane. If the sails were turning, then they believed they'd fly. And if the sails were still, then there'd be no ops that night. And there was a certain amount of scientific sense in that. because if there was no wind up here, then there'd probably have going to be a fog. And if they couldn't see the sails at all, then it was probably clampus dampus already. And what started out as a piece of simple weather lore became a sort of superstition. And air crew were rather prone to superstition. I suppose it was a way of trying to even up the odds. The physical atmosphere was pretty abnormal, and echoes of that atmosphere remain. Time and nature take their toll, crack the runways and the taxi track, break the windows and the brickwork. But in nature, nothing ever really dies. It just becomes another form of its own element. Maybe it's the same with time, but some things linger on. It seems to be especially like that where life has been cut short. Old battlefields and sites of massacres. Old airfields, too. All over Lincolnshire, you'll hear stories about that.
I think the first instance that I had of something being very interesting was going over the old airfield at about 6 o'clock one morning, and something impelled me to stop the car, get out, and just walk up the old runway. And I think it was at that moment in time that you get this eerie sensation of returning bombers and quite a noise of engines coming back. And that's happened again several times since.
I felt I wasn't alone. There was another presence. I believe I saw a person in some sort of uniform of the day, leather and sort of canvassy clothes, no colours though, and the face was very, very obscure. But whatever I felt was nice. It was a thing that was. I can't really explain that very well at all, but it was something that was.
I was stood under the balcony, under the watchtower. And while I was there, I looked over a ploughed field and saw two people walking obliquely past me. They weren't looking at me at all. And as they went past me, they disappeared out of my line of sight behind a tree. And they never came out the other side. But they were walking as though they were walking along a path rather than across a ploughed field.
I was in an old hangar and the wind was blowing. It was fairly late one Friday night, and suddenly out of nowhere came this horrifying scream. It was rather shattering to hear it, and we had no idea as to what caused it. And myself and a few friends went looking around some of the old huts and buildings which were still up at that time, and we couldn't find anything at all.
By the time East Kirkby Aerodrome was built, the heavy bombers of the RAF were no longer alone in the offensive against Germany. U.S. Army Air Force had come to join the battle. Daylight missions, big formations, pinpoint targets. That was how they worked. We thought they did it very well, many times against the odds. They left echoes, too. There's the case of the Flying Fortress that crashed here in this field on the 30th of December, 1944. They still find pieces of it every time they plough. It had taken off from an American base in Bedfordshire at 9 o'clock that morning to join a big formation going to Germany. Their target was Bulle in the Rhineland. Fortresses assembled, took up their positions in the air armada, and fought their way through to the target. Each aircraft carried 6 1,000-pound bombs. The 749 was in a lot of trouble, and the pilot knew he'd never make it back to Bedfordshire. Holding things together very carefully, he reached the coast of Lincolnshire and picked the nearest airfield for a landing. That airfield was East Kirkby. With 2 sick engines and the unfamiliar pattern, he didn't look too good on the approach. Silk sheen wouldn't let him land. Tried again, but still, he wasn't lined up right. Once, when I was in a fix like this, I got lucky, third time round. No such luck for the American. Number 29749 ran out of sky. The fire was immediate and all-consuming, far too fierce for the little tender from the airfield to put out. Later, they brought the bodies out, charred, and changed from human shape. Some people think that happenings like that don't have a time scale, that they set up a sort of ripple in the atmosphere that goes on and on. Maybe somebody in that flying fortress wanted to tell the people in the tower just how it was that day, and still keeps wanting to. One man who believes that is Fred Panton.
As a boy of 8, working on his father's farm, he saw the missed approaches and the crash. Running hard across the fields, he beat the fire truck to the scene. He saw the burning fuselage and the shape of men inside. Years later, one of those ripples in the atmosphere touched Fred.
Yes, I'd been working most of the day here and late at night, and it was a Tuesday night, and I suddenly thought, well, our local fish shop's fine, I'll go and have some fish and chips, and I jumped into my Renault and started up and got going, and I happened to just look through the hangar base towards the control tower, and I see this tall man walking towards the control tower, and he looked to be carrying a big bundle of plastic bags, and I stopped because I'd never seen anyone all day and all that. And I said to myself, who the Hanover's that? And I just thought, well, I don't suppose he's doing any harm. I carried on to fetch some fish and chips. And I suddenly thought, when I got on the main road, I'd heard about this before, and I thought, I'll bet that was the same man that I saw that I'd been told about. And I thought about it in bed and all the next day, and I'm convinced that's what I saw.
Someone else who felt the ripple was Dennis Brown. They call him Den round here. He works with Fred close by the airfield. Den was doing a bit of soldering on the first floor of the watchtower in what used to be the signals room. No other way out of the tower. Fred Panton and Den Brown weren't the only ones to feel those ripples. Not too many folks in these parts like to spend too long in here alone. Strangely, though, the figure with the parachute hasn't been seen since the watchtower was restored. Not so far, anyway. It's not far from the watchtower to the guardroom, where they used to keep the naughty airmen overnight. And one night in 1944, an aircraft had a nasty swing on takeoff. Its starboard wheel came through the guardroom wall and only missed an airman in the cell by inches. The next morning, the padre called in on his rounds and spoke to the defaulter. He said, "Remember, the wrath of the Lord will seek out the wrongdoer wherever he may hide." The guardroom isn't there anymore, but there's something in its place. Something to remind East Kirkby of the men who never got to carve their names on the table. That oak table at the Red Lion and the resurrected watchtower are both memorials in their own way to the squadrons of East Kirkby. And this one is perhaps more formal. It shows the squadron crests and mottos. 630 squadrons is pretty straightforward, death by night. Now, 57, they were the parent squadron, and their motto, if I read it right, means my body may change, but not my spirit. Corpus non animum muto. It was put up by some of the survivors. Nothing too grand, just what they could do and what they could manage. And they knew that they could leave it to the people round here to keep it in good order. And one of the squadron gunners wrote a poem
to match their thoughts.
I lie here still beside the hill, abandoned long to nature's will. My buildings down, my people gone, my only sounds, the wild bird's song. My mighty birds will rise no more, no more I hear the merlin's roar, and never now my bosom feels the pounding of the giant wheels. From ageless hills their voice cast thunderous echoes of the past, and still, in lonely reverie, their great dark wings sweep down to me. Laughter, sorrow, hope and pain, I shall never know these things again. Emotions that I came to know of strange young men so long ago. Who knows, as evening shadows meet, are they here still, a phantom fleet? And do my ghosts still stride unseen across my face so wide and green? Now weeds grow high, obscure the sky. Oh, remember me when you pass by. For beneath this tangled leafy screen, I was your home, your friend, Silk Sheen.
Legends, myths, memories of the 1940s, all centered here. It's nice to know that one of these buildings is going to be preserved as a reminder of the spirit of those times. With all the changing world around, this building will bear witness to that unchanging spirit, corpus non animum muto. Perhaps that's why, although most people nowadays would think of this as air traffic or flying control, to those of us who knew it as it was, it'll always be the Watchtower.
Gunner behind.